You can start to move.
So this workflow thing, I guess I will just give you one again perspective from UI, because from API it wasn't clear exactly what your people was doing, how the configuration works. So basically, this is our configuration what we use in Punjab. So it has two steps which citizen can perform, that is initiate and apply. And after that, there will be one step for document verification, followed by field inspection approval, and then payment can be done either through employee or through citizen. Both can do the payment. So I will just quickly apply through citizen and show how it goes to employee inbox. Then employee can take actions as given by workflow, and then again citizen can pay.
So I think Shashikala ji, Vipin, if you remember, we covered this as part of our TL discussion also on Friday, right? So you want them to go again once more from the UI, or do you guys? So I just wanted to check, are you guys clear what workflow actually refers to?
Yeah, that's what that approval mechanism or whatever it may be, admin side.
Correct. Correct. Correct.
Activities, whatever, what will be done.
Yeah. Go ahead now. Go ahead, Anthony.
So should I continue with UI? I can show
Yeah.
other calls also, API calls, so that then we can move on to the services.
Vipin.
Actually, he was sharing, means Omkar, why he was sharing this is so that he can explain the flow, how the things are happening with a service perspective. So it's better at least one flow he explained, then he continue for the next one.
Fair. Go ahead, Aniket, please.
Okay, so I'm now logged in as a citizen. So I will just first quickly apply for one trade license. So this is the first create step I was explaining. So what happens in this state is in UI for every business model which uses workflow, our first two components are initiate and apply. Means, those are the actions which they send. So all of our workflow configurations, that's why we start with the specific states. We can change it if it require, but then you will have to make the changes in the UI component as well. So now what happened is on the null state it has taken this initiate action. So if you can see here, the action was sent as initiate by the application. So the next state where it will send this is the applied state, after which it can enter, after which the employee can now start taking the action, like document verification and field inspection, etc. So some a document upload is required for this applied state.
Here, that's what in the action when we are specifying, we specified this is the document in document required or not. One state we mentioned in the state. Okay, but what and all documents are required? Again, that mapping is where we have defined.
No. So that actually we don't have that feature in this version. So we will be adding that in action. So for a particular action, we will verify whether some those specified documents are there or not. Currently, it just checks if documents are there, not the type of document. So there is this feature called is doc upload required, right? So if it's true, then you will have to upload document. But we currently don't have that feature to specify exactly which document he has to upload on which action. that we will be adding in next version, where we will be add the list of document required to perform a particular action.
So when I say the TL create request, so I know what and all documents should be supposed to be uploaded, and that we have defined in some different flow.
Yeah, so
here, see, we have listed three things that three document has to be uploaded.
Yeah, so this these three things are there, right? Owner ID proof, ownership proof, and owner's photo. So this thing, this comes from MDMS data. So you have an MDMS data which UI refers required documents, and backend doesn't do any validation what documents they are. It just sees whether documents are being sent to it.
Okay, so that MDMS configuration we have defined in MDMS JSON. That
service. Yeah, in trade license module.
I
will share. I will show the MDMS structure once we are done with this.
Okay.
Yeah. So then when we click on submit, it will just call the update API. Update with apply action. So as I explained before, this transition API won't be called directly from the UI. So UI will just call TL create and update, and it will internally call this transition API, which will create this process instance audits in the workflow table. So now this is the application number. It's generated by the system. So if we go to this employee inbox, so whenever you enter an employee inbox, it will make a search call to workflow. So this is a search call to workflow. So what it doesn't send any parameter except the tenant ID. So what workflow does is it fetches all the roles belonging to this user from this auth token, and once it gets the role, it will return the list of applications on which these roles can take action. So if we see now this. A particular application is now in pending for document verification state. Now we have given all the roles to this user so that we don't have to again log in and log out. So after clicking on that, it searches this particular process instance now. So if we look at the response of this particular process instance, it has two process instances. The first entry is for the initiated state, and another is for the apply state. In view history, we can see that two actions have been performed, and details are there. If you add any comments or whatever documents we have uploaded, can be seen here. So what UI will do is next, from the latest state, that is the applied state, it will see this next actions. This backend populates and sends this next action, which will be shown here. So according to the configuration which we defined, this menu will be populated. So if I just verify and forward here, here you can select assignee if you want to assign to someone. It doesn't matter much because ours is a role-based workflow. So if you just assign it to someone, it will be just shown to assign to me. But anyway, it will be there in this all also, where you can take the action. So because we have given all the roles to this particular employee, he can perform all actions. So next, we will just do again verify and forward. This will send it to the approval state. Generally, in production, different employees will have to do these different actions. But here, for testing, we have just given everything to the same employee.
Aniket?
Yeah.
Aniket, actually, multiple counter like employees will have this option, right? Clerks are having the same option, suppose.
Same option.
So in that case, one person is having the option of approve, and another person is having like option of verify and approve, and both the clerks are getting the same application in their inbox.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, no? So is it possible like one person has done verify and one person has done, suppose one person selected reject and the other person on the same time or something like that approve, is something like that will happen?
So what will happen is, if the application is some state X, and if there are two actions which can be performed on it by two separate person, so as soon as the first one takes an action, the state of that application will change. So suppose even if the other employee is looking at the same state and he is able to take the action from UI, but backend will throw error because the application would have been moved to the next state.
Okay, okay.
So it might happen that UI might not get updated because you will have to refresh the APIs. But
okay.
Yeah, backend will throw error.
Backend will throw. Okay, okay, fine.
Aniket, this keywords that you have mentioned, right, like initiated, applied. So yeah, those keywords are in like database, MDMS, or in like where it has been mapped?
Actually, I guess it must be somewhere in UI. I'm not exactly sure how from where UI is picking it up. I guess in UI session, they can tell you all these first two components they have designed.
Okay.
So like, in, yeah, so all of our this trade license, FireNC, and these services are using this common two components where they send initiate on the after.
So they're part of the product ontology itself now.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we use them uniformly across a couple of products, which include trade license, property tax, PGR, and FireNC.
For workflow, it doesn't matter. Workflow can, you can put whatever states you want for workflow, but to use the existing components, we just use that as a nomenclature to convention to put the first as initiate and second as apply.
Aniket, this configuration file, you are sending it to a service, right?
Yeah, so
this data, you are sending it to the service, right?
Yeah, yeah. Workflow service will store it into DB. So this is the DB structure of workflow. So these three tables are there. This is the business top level object. Then all the states will be stored in this table, and actions will be in this another action table. And whatever application comes, their record will be stored as a single entry in this process instance. Anyway, so a single record will be there for each process instance here.
Okay. My question is, why are we having it separately? Means why there are multiple instances of it? Means this workflow is something that is fixed, right?
So yeah, for workflow there are no for workflow there will be always a single instance. So if you check this business service table,
okay.
So see, there are only two workflows. One is defined for Amritsar and one is defined for Jalandhar. So there will be a single entry for a workflow, but for each application which is entering the workflow, there will be separate entries. So this is the process instance table.
Okay.
So for this, there will be multiple entries. So whatever application comes here, like these are their application numbers. For each application, there will be separate entry, but workflow will be one single entry here.
Okay.
So as soon as suppose the employee is logging in into the application, so from this table, the data will be fetched based on the status of the application, right?
Yeah. So as soon as the employee logs in his inbox, we are making that workflow search call. So what will happen is, he has an auth token. Zool will enrich the user roles for that auth token, and we from the business service, we will find the roles. From the business service, we will fetch the states on which his roles can take action, and only show him the applications in those state. Means suppose he has a TL counter employee role, and if TL counter employee can take action only on applied state, so we will show him all the applications belonging to applied state in his inbox.
So basically, there is a reference in the process table to the configuration table, right?
Yeah, correct. So if you see here. So if you see here, this UUID of the status is stored. So it knows exactly in which status this application is there, and based on that, we populate the next action whenever search call comes. depending on the role of the user.
Okay.
So we store the
this table has a reference to the other table which you have shown.
Yeah, it has a reference to the state table. State table will have reference to the, so this table will have reference to the state table, and state table has the reference to business and the action table.
Aniket, when we were defining the workflow, we added only two types, either it's a consumer or it's a TL employee. Okay.
Yeah.
We have not defined the individual person role. So, where is that mapping that this person can do this action or needs?
So that will be done by HRMS. So there is one service called HRMS service, which is used to create employees that are users. So while creating, we assign roles to them. So once employees are created, whenever they log in, Zool will enrich their roles and send it to the trade license service. Then trade license service will send it forward to the workflow service to verify. So while creating, only we assign the roles.
Then do we need to, Omkar, then this HRMS is also part of our this trade license and mCollect?
Yes, Shashikala ji, HRMS is also part of the. So through HRMS, we'll be able to create users and assign them roles, right?
That means we need to collect that data also from them?
Correct. HRMS data. No, so I think we've anyways discussed during the MDMS session, right? So all the users which you need to operate the system, they will also be part of the data collection, right?
That's what, like, we have not added. Maybe we need to add that set also.
Correct.
That is employees related information also we need to collect from them.
So either you can collect that information, or you there is a user interface which you, if you remember, Malti had taken this in the MDMS UI session. So you can add
there
the user.
Can add it.
Correct. You can add them directly.
Okay.
Omkar, that point only. Like in that we assigned that okay, he's a collector. He's or means he's an approver, that level. But here we are saying each and every action.
Say that again.
When we say the HRMS, we were adding the employee and we were assigning the role. Mm-hmm. That particular role, and we will be able to see this what comes in approver. Again, this state is defined somewhere different, and that role is assigned somewhere in different file.
Okay. So what happens if you submit this request? Okay, let me just call one API call. Okay, suppose this is the take action and I approve this application now. Okay, so if you look at the update call, whenever you log in through an employee, you will send this request info in all your body, in all API bodies. So you will have this auth token, which will be given when you log in. So from this auth token, it first goes to Zool Gateway. Zool Gateway will in turn then add a user info, something like this. This will be enriched by the Zool, and then it will be sent to the trade license service. So when it comes to trade license service, it will get something like this in request info. So it will know what roles this particular employee has. And from there, it will forward this to workflow. So workflow will also then verify these roles against this action he wants to take.
Okay, just one thing. Maybe I may be wrong, but there are three files in the MDMS data. One is action, action and role mapping. Okay. And so action and role mapping is done. But here it's somewhat like means action. If I say it's a create only workflow/create or workflow/update, that is my action.
Yeah.
In that there are seven steps. You can say actions.
Yeah. Okay. Correct.
So out of the seven action, this action and this particular state is assigned for the approval, or this is assigned to the counter employee.
Yeah. Okay.
Where is
okay.
That?
Yeah. So there is this call. Okay. So if you enter any application, let's take something like pending for payment. Suppose I go in this application, it will call workflow search. And workflow search will have this next action. So what it does is it takes the roles of the user and it will search it against the business service and then map the next action that can be taken by this particular employee. So these two actions you can see ad icon, ad hoc and pay has come in as search response. So ad hoc, I don't know. Anyway. So it comes from your workflow search response.
Okay.
So let me try to pay this application.
So whenever you call pay, right, we will first call fetch bill API, which is a part of billing service. Anyway, this part we will explain later. So this was the application which was created by this citizen. So if you go to his My Applications, you can see that this application number is approved now because we paid from that employee screen there. Okay.
Yeah, Nikki.
I can show one online payment here if you want. So this is another application which I created. So citizen can take this pay action here. Okay. So this will basically redirect to a gateway, and then it will internally call a payment create, which is like a registry for storing the payments. So it's saying payment has been successful. Now, if you check, this application has been also approved. So if you see, we didn't call update API here. What happens is like once we call the payment create, it will call the collection service and trade license keep listening on that topic, receipt topic. So whenever it gets any TL payment, it will internally update the status to approve. We can do it from UI, but if other call fails, then that will be like a wrong entry, data mismatch. So we do it in an async manner here. Here we call the, in async we call the payment. So any questions here for in workflow?
One thing, just now you did the payment and you tried with a payment gateway and didn't do any actual transaction and you were able to return back. So
yeah.
Means it's again in UAT, do we have some, I mean, how we do that?
It must be some environment variable. I'm not sure about PG service. We'll have another KT session for PG service. I guess Nitin will add to that.
But
it's just the environment variable.
Okay.
But simulator,
you have already had a session for payment gateway.
It was just like customization one, I guess. It was not the service. I don't know. Anyway, we can have another session for payment.
Okay.
Fine. So we can start with, I guess, miscellaneous collection one. Kavi? Are there any questions on workflow or is it fine?
So it's a, again, this all will be different. I mean, can we get the template as such which you have?
Yeah, yeah, sure. I'll share all the documentation with you.
Documentation, I think it's there in billing service, that part only, that page only, means after that.
You want business
service. Page. Yeah.
You want the business service.
Postman service calls, means as such for the workflow.
I will share those. I guess it will be there. If it's not there, I will just share. Anyway, we can do local setup now after this KTs, and that time only we can set it up.
Okay.
Kavi?
Hello.
Okay, once the request goes to the Zoom server, right? So with the user authentication, after that part, could you please repeat once again? It was not much clear.
So what happens is, first of all, this. One second. So every API. So we have three types of API. One is like whitelisted, which directly goes. Second is mixed endpoint. So in mixed endpoint, we just attachment default user info. It's sort of whitelisted only, but we just attach a default user info because code requires it. And the third one is our normal authorization one, where first what happens is it goes through this role action mappings. I will just show you the MDML data. So we have these two files. This is one first action test JSON, and second one is this role action. So basically, here we defined all the URLs and its ID. And in this second file, we define a role and the action ID. So basically, we say like for this ID means whatever URL this ID represents, this role can access that URL. So what happens is when you send a auth token. Zool will internally call user service and will fetch this user info, like to whom this auth token was assigned. So it will fetch this user info, and depending on the roles, first Zool will either authorize or decline that request. If it's authorized, then further it will come to the business service, which if has any validation based on the rules, case of workflow, it will proceed with it further. So Zool will fetch the user info based on the auth token from the user service. User service stores the auth. Is it fine?
Yeah.
So I guess I will start with this demand query. And I will just start with the demand. So let me just start with the payment part, like this demand, what is demand, billing and collection. So basically the first I will just explain you the three masters which we have. So whenever you create a new service, you will just define that business service in this MDMS data. So what it does is it allows us to control the modes of payment and the minimum amount payable and whether partial payment is allowed or not, all those things. So first we have to make an entry in this business service JSON. After that, we will have to add the tax heads in the tax head master. So these are basically given by the client only. So suppose like in case of property tax, we have the base property tax, the rebate, interest, owner exemption, ad hoc penalties, unit usage exemption. So these are basically different tax groups, you can say, or tax heads, sort of like that. So you have a base tax. Apart from base tax, you have some interest, rebate, or whatever things. So they are stored under a different tax heads, which we define here. And after that, you have a tax period. So for every tax, for every business service, you have to provide a tax period for which it is active. So you can always provide a superset, and if the tax period is in between that, it will be accepted, else it will be rejected. This is just to control that no one pays something, means for years which we haven't made the payment active. So as we go to next year, we add this entry. So I will just go through TL calculator once to show how we create T1s. So demand is the so this demand object is the most basic record. Basically, what it stores is the total amount to be collected and for what tax headmaster we are collecting this amount. So for example, this is one demand for water and sewerage business service. So it says that your water and sewerage charge is 100 rupees. Currently collected amount is zero and the rebate you will be getting is minus 50. So all discounts and rebates, we use a negative sign for it. And the collected amount is zero. So demand is basically the permanent record payment transaction for a given entity. So suppose you have a property with property ID as PT1. So you make a payment for suppose you create a property and assess it for a year 2016-17. Then there will be one demand created for that particular period, which will go here as tax period from and tax period to. And this from and to is period is taken from the master, which I showed you before, this tax period master. So for this particular period, this bill will be generated and payment will happen for this given period. For the next year, when you come, your consumer code, which is the property ID, will remain same, but your tax period from and tax period to will keep changing every year. So consumer code is basically the primary ID against which you track payments across time periods. So in case of property tax, we have the property ID. Then for trade license, we have the application number. So basically, this is the ID which won't change across different billing cycles. So based on demand, you will generate a bill. So bill is nothing but just a snapshot of your demand. So you just have to send the consumer code and the tenant ID and also the business service. So for this given consumer code, it will billing service will search all the demands. So you can have multiple demands, each belonging to a separate tax period. That is the tax period from and tax period to. So when you call this billing service, but I can show this with an example. Let me create a demand for 50 rupees. So if you see now, I have just created one demand. So it's a record and this consumer code, this is like sort of a tracking number, which we can track all the payments for this particular demand. So I have created this for this tax period from and this tax period to. So the total amount payable is 50 rupees, that is 100 minus this 50. So if I just fetch a bill for this amount, so what billing service does basically, it will consolidate across demands. So if I have two demands, it will just merge both those demands. So if you see now the bill is something around 50 rupees, that is this 100 minus 50. So let me just create another demand. Let me just change something. Somewhere for different tax period.
Nikit, can you please zoom this REST portal, Postman portal, if possible? I don't know how it is.
What?
Can you just zoom that Postman client?
Yeah.
Because it's pixelated a bit. Yeah, it's better. Yeah.
Okay. So what I did before was I created one demand for a given tax period, which was this for this tax period, and then I generated a bill. So the total amount is 50 for that. Suppose someone comes and wants to generate it for some another billing cycle. It might be next year or previous year, whatever it is. So let's say it's 200 here and 50. So it should be total one. This demand will be of 150 rupees. So now for that same consumer code, we have created another demand for 150 rupees. And the previous one was 50 rupees. So now if we fetch the bill again, you can see now the amount has become 200. So what it did, it just consolidated the both the demands. The first demand was for 50 rupees and the second one was for 150 rupees. And each demand is kept as an entry in this bill detail. So we had those two demands, right? So each demand is kept as an entry for a given bill detail. So this one is the second one. And this one is the first one. So bill is nothing. It's just a snapshot of your demand. So basically, at a given point of time, what is the current amount pending and how much is paid? So it just consolidates that for a given consumer code. So once I get the bill, I can just fetch the bill ID and do a payment for it. It's 200. So in payment, you have to just give your bill details. So this payment detail is an array. You can pay for multiple bills here. So it will just keep adding the it as entry in this array. And then you have to tell the payment mode. It's basically by what mode of payment you are paying, making the payment. And the mobile number, payer name, and the transaction number. So in case of online payments, you don't have to call this payment create API as it will be internally called by the payment gateway service. But in case of cash and check and all those payments which happens on the counter, you will the UI will call it from there. So now I have registered a payment of 200 against that consumer code. So what happens is collection service will internally call another service called apportion service. Apportion service will apportion the amount and distribute into the tax heads. So if you see here, this WS charge adjusted amount is 200. That is, this is the amount to be collected for this particular tax head, and this is the amount collected against that tax head. So if you see now, we have done a complete payment. So all tax heads will be balanced now. So for whatever is the amount that has to be paid has been is the adjusted amount now. So that is the part of apportioning service to distribute the paid amount in the tax head. So in case of partial amount, partial payment, what happens is you will have to give a priority. So if you look at this tax periods, sorry, tax head master, we have defined orders for each tax head. So the tax head with the lowest order will be picked first by the apportioning service. So if you see like in this unit exemption as the first one, then ad hoc penalty, then property tax. So in this order, it will apportion the bill. So if you pay 1,000 rupees and your property tax is of 2,000, first it will fill the tax head of PT user's exemption, then ad hoc penalty, and whatever remaining amount will go to PT tax here, adjusted amount. So it won't be complete 200, it will be some 10 rupees or 20 rupees, depending whatever you have paid, whatever the remaining amount is there for that particular tax set. Now, if you again call bill on this same consumer code, you will see that the total amount to be paid is zero, because whatever was the bill, we have made complete payment for that particular bill. So this is like the basic flow of how we manage the payments in our system. So any questions you have?
Aniket?
Yeah.
Our system will be aiding the user for how much amount need to be paid. Mm-hmm. For example, as a citizen, sometimes we won't be aware, like how much is the amount for this particular financial year and all. So that will be auto-calculated and will be populated for us, right?
So we will have to write the calculator service for that. So what happens, this demands property service and trade license service both have their own calculator services, which which creates this demand for them. So based on the data which we send them, right, trade type and whatever we choose, they have a defined billing slab stored in their DB. From okay. that, they will pick up the charges, and there is also this penalty master. So this interest rates and the starting period, everything is defined by the client. So okay. this calculator service actually calculates the amounts for those particular tax sets, and then mm-hmm. it sends it to demand.
Okay. But, yeah, tell me.
So if you don't have calculator, then it will be like a ad hoc penalty or ad hoc charge, where whatever the employee wants to fill, he can fill, like in miscellaneous okay. collection, where okay, okay. Whatever details the employee wants to fill, he can fill, and it will be that amount of bill will be generated.
This option is open to citizens also, right? Not only for the employees.
Which option?
I mean for this paying tax or paying any of the like now yeah. we are.
So what's happened is like employee has access only to Fetchbill API. So if you see, there are three APIs which goes in doing a payment. First is this demand create, which mm-hmm. is done internally. No one internally calculator will call it, and calculator is called by your business service okay. like trade license or property. So this no one has access to. Internally it will be created. After mm-hmm. that, Fetchbill citizen have access to Fetchbill because it's just the bill, like how much he has to pay. But payment create, we don't give access to citizen because this is the entry that he has paid the amount.
Okay.
So this only citizen has access to this API. And for employee, he always has the online payment option where he can pay, and internally it will call this payment create.
Okay. So first of all, when we are customizing our things, we have to give the tax slabs and all those details in our DB, right? For the calculation.
Yeah. You, in short, the start, the thing which, the only thing which you have to do is create this demand detail. So this two fields, I mean, what n number of this demand details, whatever is required by you, this you just have to fill. After that, the flow will be common for, means common is what we use. Because okay, we don't know what tax amount you want for a given tax.
Okay, but the charges varies. That's charges we need to fed in DB, right? You told like we have to call from the calculator service, and it will be fetching the details from the DB, and based on that the calculation is made. So yeah. that means we have to specify our required whatever be the amounts that we need to fed in DB, correct? No?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, fine.
So first that calculator service will run, and then that amount will be populated in the tax amount, right?
Yeah, so calculator service will create one tax head estimates, like it will find estimate. One second, I'll just show you the code.
Could you zoom this also, please?
Oh, sorry. Is it fine now? I'm not able to zoom actually. Are you able to see now?
Yeah, manageable. Yeah, it's okay. We can proceed.
Yeah, I'm not able to zoom for that.
It's okay. So, we can proceed.
Okay. So if you see here in this service, this is our calculation service. So basically, it takes this calculation request, which is sent by our business service, which is nothing but this trade license body. It will send trade license body. So from the trade license body, it will fetch whatever fields it requires for doing the calculation, like the trade type, what accessories are given, and what is the financial year. Then after extracting those fields, it will search in DB, like what rate is defined for that particular slab, and then it will put it in against a particular tax head, like the base tax. This is used to calculate the base tax. But then you might have another charges called ad hoc charges or whatever. So that is also sent in the directly in the trade license body only. So that will go under a different tax head called ad hoc penalty or ad hoc rebate, according to your definitions. So to be like exactly what is your requirement? You are going to get some data, or is it like ad hoc payments, like what we do in miscellaneous collection?
That we are not yet sure how the requirement is. So,
okay. So this calculator part is where you might have to do. You might have to rewrite, because currently what TL calculator and PT calculator does is it's defined for the given contracts only. Like PT calculator requires the property object, and TL calculator requires the trade license object. And based on its custom logics, like how the interest is calculated and how the penalties are calculated, it populates this tax heads. Means like here for water charge and rebate is there. So this rebate calculation will be specific to PT, and TL might require its own different calculation.
Okay. The calculation request that is generated, right? So from where it is generated? Does the counter employee generates the request, or is it generated based on like suppose the financial year has started, so we have to start the collection, so the it will automatically calculate the the request calculation.
Yeah, so what happens is you have seen this trade license or object, right? So basically what happens is you call this TL create or TL update on every step, right? So it will internally call TL calculators API underscore what it's called underscore calculate and send the whole trade license object to it. Now TL calculations depends on accessories, trade type, and the financial year. So it will just fetch those that data from that request, and then find the matching billing slab in the DB.
So this happens during the creation part.
In every step we call in TL, in create also, and in update also. So during creation part, we actually create the demand, but because we give edit functionality, he might change the trade type, right? So the amount will change. Therefore, we keep updating the demand every time he calls update also. We recalculate because he can change the fields which affects his tax.
Okay.
So if in edit he changes the UM value or something, which will change the total tax he has to pay. Therefore, we keep doing recalculations every time he calls update. Means he goes to next step. We recalculate the tax, update the demand accordingly.
Okay.
And we always have this ad hoc penalty and ad hoc rebate as two extra charges which the employee can give. So they are like, if there is some calculation problem or some mismatch, the employee, the counter employee can directly put some 50 rupees off or some 100 rupees penalty, whatever you want, and that will go as an extra tax. It will bypass our calculator.
Okay.
So this is our this is our payment flow works. Let me go through the TL. Is this time visible to you guys?
If you could zoom, it would be better.
now. Is it fine now?
Yeah,
it's a little blur anyway. So this is like normally all of our models follow the same business models follow the same kind of web sequence diagram. So what's happened is like client will first send one create request to our business service. The business service will run some validations like it will cross check the MDMS data or something like that. So for that, it will have to fetch the MDMS data. So internally, the service will first call MDMS service, get whatever the required MDMS data is. So like if you see for trade license, what it does is it fetches this trade license MDMS. We have a separate folder for it. So it will fetch all this data. Out of that, suppose for one validation, for example, it will, whatever trade type you send, right, it will validate whether it's present in this master data. So for that, almost all services will call the MDMS service to fetch the required master data. So that's with the MDMS service. After that, whichever service has owner involved in it will call the user service. So none of the user data will be stored with the business service. It will just store a reference to the UUID. All the PIs will be stored in this user service, which we have encrypted. So whatever your name, mobile number, and everything will be stored in user service. User service will give one UUID, which will be stored in TL service table. So whenever TL search call comes to TL service, it will fetch the data from user service and then return it back to client. It won't store it in its own table. It will just have the reference from user service. After that, we have this IDGen service, which is basically generates IDs, like whatever application numbers we have seen before, these application numbers, then license number. All these numbers are generated by IDGen service. So we just have to define a MDMS master, which defines what is the format in which you require the number. So I will just quickly show the MDMS master for it. So this is the MDMS master for IDGen service. So IDGen service always loads this master before starting. And these are the ID names which you define in your service. So for trade license, if you see, so these are the IDs which we have defined for trade license. So this is the trade license receipt format. So like this entries you will have to make. So for that particular format, it will generate a ID belonging to this particular format and return it to the service. So if you see, there is one sequence generator which is required. If it's not there, IDGen will create it on its own. So these formats and that you can find in documentation, like this will replace that with year. Basically, these are date formats. This is a sequence which will keep incrementing. So you can find whatever this CT.code will replace it with the tenant ID. So this you can find in the documentation. So you just have to define a particular format here, and depending on that format, it will create this IDs like this, customized ID. So that's what IDGen service will do. Then after that, if you have an integration with workflow service, then you need to make a call to a workflow service. It will just create an entry in process instance table. Then after that, we are making a call to a calculator service. So calculator service will then make internal call to billing service, which will create the demand, whatever flow we saw, right? So the only job of calculator service is to give this two values, means two or whatever values for the tax sets, like what is the base tax, interest, rebate. So it will just calculate those, and it will call demand service to create this demand. So whenever we call create or update, demand will be automatically created, will get created in the background. So calculation service will take care of creating demands. Then after that demand is created, we will this call is not. So after demand is created, we put the data on the Kafka. Actually, this is the old architecture where we had billing service call inside, but now it's removed. Now you can directly call billing service to get the bill. So once we call the tax calculation service, after that we will just push the data on Kafka. So we don't persist the data in synchronization. We just put it on a Kafka topic. And from there, persister will pick it up. I will show you the persister configuration. So same flow almost goes for update also. It's actually not very clear. It's getting blurred here. I will just show it in code. So basically, almost this is what all that diagram meant. So are you guys able to see this? So this is the first MDMS call goes, then these are some internal validations. After that, enrichment. This enrichment will call the ID gen service to get the IDs, and then it will enrich the application number. After that, it will do some validations. Then it will call user service here in this create user to send the user data and get the reference back from there. Then add calculation will just call the calculation service, which will create the demand from where we can get the bill. Then it will call the workflow service to, if workflow is enabled, it will call the workflow service to make an entry of it. And then we have just this repository.save. So basically it's just a Kafka template which pushes the data for on a given topic. So this topic we have in our application.property, on this topic, it will just push this whole object. So let me just show you the persister config. So basically, persister config is nothing but just the insert or update query, whichever we are required. So we just wanted to separate out the DB repository part. So therefore, we just write these configurations and everything is loaded into persister. So when this persister service starts, it has one application.properties where it asks for the config paths. You can see it here. So this is overwritten in the environment anyway. So it will fetch all these YAMLs for all the services, and it will load this YAMLs into it. So if you see in this particular YAML, it's listening on this topic save -tl-thread license. So that producer.push function, which is here, so this get save topic has this value in application.properties. So it will push that data on this particular topic, and once it is pushed, persister will consume that record, and it will run this set of queries on it. So these queries are a prepared statement where these JSON paths are first executed to get this value. So whatever, like first this is ID, so we'll have to mention the JSON path from where we can fetch this particular value. So any questions?
Aniket, like, you're saying like for TL, we have to customize it. Okay. For TL service.
Mm-hmm.
Not TL service, calculator service. Okay.
Yeah.
So is there any well-specified hooks, or we have to completely customize the service? Particular service endpoint where the calculation happen in that we can modify based on that.
Yeah, you just have to modify one class actually. If you just modify this one class, everything is fine. So just override this one method in calculation service. So this calculator service is there. Inside this get calculation is there, which not even this. This get tax head estimates. So if you just are able to override this method, the rest of the code you can reuse. So you just have to send the tax head and the value again, and tax head and the value that has to be paid against it in this tax head estimate. So if you look at this tax head estimates, so basically there is this. So basically just you have to send the tax head code and estimate amount. These other things are not required. These are just for audit, like what billing slab we did to, what billing slab we used to do the calculations. If you want, you can put the value, if not, fine. But this is the important one, tax head estimate. So if you just write a function which provides this tax head estimate, then rest of the part you can reuse.
Creating so we will be directly. And what is the pattern to override this method? We will be creating one implementation class, and in that we will be writing, or we will be directly modifying this particular class only as such.
So actually what we did in property is like there was one customization came for FireSys calculation. So okay. There we did is we put one post hook which modified the response. But I think better approach will be to just put a functional level hook on this calculation service. We can provide you with a functional level hook where you can just put one annotation here, which will override this method. Just write your custom method for that.
Okay. No, so, as such, in general, what is your practice?
So our current practice is to not touch the code at all. Just put a post hook or pre hook over the entire service. But that's like a very complicated thing to do. We just have to do the whole thing again. So I think we can do a functional level hook. I will have to talk with other people also regarding this. But functional level hook will be more practical, I feel like, rather than post or pre hooks, then you will have to override the whole logic also.
Okay.
Currently, if you just have minor changes, then functional level hook we can implement. If some major changes are there, then we can put a post or pre hook directly.
Okay. And like this tax slabs and all that, it's happen on means financially it's starting, right?
Yeah, client and implementation team take care of it, means updating the slabs and everything.
Okay, so at that time they have to update the MDMS JSON for that data. Particular financial year and master data, and based on that it automatically, or maybe some again event is there which something like button type event, or it's automatically do this?
No, they manually update this master data for now.
They update this master data, then based on this updation?
We just have to restart the MDMS service.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So it will just again pull from the git and the updated data.
Okay.
So
Aniket. Aniket,
yeah.
If any tag slab changes happens, so in that case, suppose we are having any backlogs, for example, from 2020 onwards, the tag slab has been changed for this particular this property tags, but from 2019, it was something different. And when we are paying the tax, that is, suppose I had some backlog. So in that case, how do we need to handle it? Because now we will be changing the tax slab, right, in our MDMS. So whatever is the backlog wala amount, that will not be, that will be different.
Yeah. So basically, means you will have to run one cron job, which will update all those demands. But what our calculator does, it's whenever you return it a particular calculation rate, it will match it against the demand. And whatever the diff will be there, the difference, it will just add another demand detail for it. So in case of property tax, we have daily interest. So suppose yesterday a citizen came and he checked his bill and the interest was some 100 rupees. Mm-hmm. And after 10 days he comes to pay, then again fetch bill will internally call update demand.
Okay.
It's calculation service one. Means he will go through property update. So it will recalculate that interest, and if it comes as 110, it will add another 10 rupees as a new demand detail there.
Okay.
So in your case, if you change the MDMS data and if you recalculate everything, means you just have to write one searcher config. Searcher config is basically it just searches from DB.
Okay.
So you will have to write one cron job. We have a generic cron job. You just means have to expose one endpoint which will just update all the calculations. You just have to call your calculate function again, and the rest of the part will be same. The demand will then just add the extra difference in it automatically.
Okay, so we need to call one more service for this.
Yeah, means basically you just have to update the MDMS and then again call updates on the. I think it's not required. Even if you just update the MDMS data, right, and whenever you call fetch bill, the demand will be updated.
It will be get updated. We don't need to do
anything. It will add the difference. Yeah.
Okay. And Aniket, one more thing. That persister service, right? You have shown two things. One is in all our services, like whether it is a TL service or property tax service, we will have one YAML file. In that, we are specifying the insert and all the queries over there.
Yeah.
Correct. No? And there is one persister service. That will be calling our all the YAMLs, and we'll be reading this data from the corresponding topic.
Yeah.
Correct, no? And yeah. In our YAML, there will be multiple insertion statements, no?
Yeah. So I will just again go through the YAML ones. So these YAMLs are loaded when you start the pod, right? That time only it will fetch all these YAMLs. So if you see, for any data which comes on this topic, save TL, trade license, whatever queries are in this query maps, right?
Okay. So
you can see this is the first one, this is the second one. All these queries will get executed. And it's transactional. So if anyone fails, everything will be rolled back.
Okay.
So we have a error map also, where error topic, sorry. So if any persistence fails, then it will just push that record on that error topic. And then through either or in other tools, we can monitor if anything is failing. Generally, it won't fail, but if something fails due to some bad entry or something, we can catch it in the error topic.
Okay.
So Kavi is there? Hello? You guys have any question on this business service part, like demand, bill, payment, or how this trade license stores data? Or else I can ask to explain how we generate a PDF and
will there be a separate session for how we can create hooks, pre-hooks, post-hooks, and functional level hooks?
Yeah, we can have one session on that. Yeah.
Okay.
So we can have one session where we can explain you how we created it for FireSys in Punjab. As an example, we can show you.
Okay.
We'll schedule one another session.
Okay.
In case, right now in your TechSat Master, by default, there are some keys and we will be expecting the same to key by the client. In case if some things are not mentioned, so if we make it zero, then do we show any detail like for this particular demand? These are the TechSat Master in which we are collecting the amount. For example, the 500 breakage of 500, how we are defining this breakup of 500.
So if you miss some TechSat Master and if your calculator is calculating it and trying to call billing service, it will throw an error. So when you define your calculator, you will define those TechSat Master in it, right? Like calculate interest like this, penalty in this. And suppose you calculate and you say like put this into PT hyphen interest. And if that TechSat Master is missing from the master data, billing service will throw an error. Like this TechSat Master doesn't exist for this period.
Okay. So if I define that values as zero something, or do I have any option?
No, it will still throw an error.
Zero also?
No.
Okay.
You will have to, it has to be there if you are sending.
Okay. No, I'm saying in the master data when we are configuring it. So
master data doesn't have any amount.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Are you saying, talking about this order, is it?
No, TechSat Master only, that part only.
So this is the TechSat Master. Here, we don't keep any amount here. Means you are saying you want to make it inactive, something like that.
Yeah.
I think we haven't provided it in here. We have provided it in some other MDMS. I think we don't have that option here. We can add that, but it's fine.
Okay.
We can add one flag, yeah, active flag. It's not there currently, but we will add it.
Okay.
So anyway, we can do a local setup. That time, if you just go through this flow, it will be much clearer. Means you can make some custom changes in the calculator also. If you...
Aniket.
Yeah, Kavi, can you just explain the part where we do back update when we call fetch bill?
Okay, so they know about billing service?
Yeah, I've given a brief overview of how demand, billing, and collection.
Okay, fine. So there are multiple revenue modules, right? Like trade license, property tax, all of them will prepare their demand and will send it to billing service where the demands will be stored and bills will be generated for the same. So every demand created as a valid time period. I mean, okay, so basically the, you know, for the tax you are paying, there might be interest applicable on it or a rebate applicable on it. After some time, the rebate must become invalid. So all this update has to be done time to time basis. You know, so one of the approach we have used here is basically whenever somebody wants to get a bill, the status of the bill will be checked whether, you know, it has crossed the validity period for the interest and penalty. If it has crossed the validity period, the billing service will call the respective module based on the URLs configured in the billing service, which you can find in the application properties. So if you have checked the document for billing service, you will be able to find it there. If not, I will share the link in the same message so that you guys can view it. So basically, based on the module name, so all the bills you are requesting, the consumer code, which is basically the unique ID of the demand, will be collected and sent it to the respective module. So once the module updates the demand, it will give the response back to the billing service. Then following that, a new bill will be generated with a new validity. So that's the whole back update flow. So for every module, given the validity, billing service will check back with the module to extend the validity as per the requirement of the module. Since billing service is a generic module, the logic resides within the respective modules itself. That's why the callback to the modules. That's the simple overview. If you guys want a code walkthrough, I can do that for you.
Yeah, a code walkthrough may help.
Just show how we call that update demand, right? So, just show that update, how we call that update demand and how we set the expiry time from the time.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Just so. The expiry time for the bills will be given by the respective modules. You know, they will know when the interest should be updated, penalty should be updated. So there is a field in the demand called bill expiry time, which will be updated by the respective modules, which is basically number of days after which the bill should expire. Just give me a second. So,
coming back to that question of when we change the billing slab, right? So we always expose another API called update demand. So it does basically same thing as calculate. It just recalculates everything and updates demand. So that API link we just provide to the billing service in its configuration. So whenever fetch bill is called, it will internally call that API to just back update the demand. So even if we change the billing slabs, it will again, whenever the citizen comes for payment, it will call fetch bill API, which will internally update the demand before payment happens.
So this update demand will be always called, right? Before the
payment. Yeah, every time you call fetch bill, it will update the demand first and then return the bill.
Okay.
Aniket, it's like one time the demand has been generated, then it's like validating, not the when.
Sorry, I didn't understand.
See, when the demand has been generated, it's a one-time activity. And it's having its own expiry time. Within that time, it won't be checking for the is there any demand updated for that particular entry.
So demand doesn't have expiry time. Bill will have it. So like in case of property tax, right? Because we calculate interest daily, we set the bill expire period as the end of the day whenever we generate the bill.
Okay.
So we can explain actually much better this. Expiring.
Okay. Aniket?
Yeah.
Can you just open the billing service? Mine is not presenting some issue. I'll tell you the line number.
Yes.
Yeah, just one second. Okay. Can you go to the build service vehicle?
So this might be the URLs, right?
In application.properties, it will be the demand.update URLs. Okay. With the module colon URL. So that is the one which will be updated by the respective module people. So with their module name as the key and the URL as the value, which will be called by the billing service while validating the bill.
So whatever calculate function we defined, right? That same function we'll have to just wrap in another endpoint, or that same endpoint also we can use here. So we just have to add that entry in billing service config. Same whatever calculate API does, same endpoint.
Yeah, so it's basically the module decision. In case of property, we have extracted the method as update demand separately. Okay, so I think in trade license, we are using the whole method. So it's the module decision how they want to use it. Basically, the method should contain the code which will update the demand based on the whatever updatable things they have, whether it is interest, penalty, or rebate, whatever. Right, and
something like when you are getting the information and it's getting with billing service, where expiring is happening, then you are simply pushing it to Kafka, and the other party will billing ID. I mean, for this particular ID, you need to update the demand, something like that.
So it won't be pushed to Kafka per se. So you are calling bill fetch. Okay. So basically, you want to fetch the current bill. So billing service will check whether the bill is valid or not within its period of payable. Right, if you are barred on your bill for a month, which means you'll have to pay the fine for the next month, okay? That has to be updated by the module. Since the logic is not available, it will make a direct call to the module. Now, it won't put in Kafka or anything. So the direct call will, you know, give a response that the demand is updated. So once the demand is updated, a new bill will be generated in the billing service itself.
Okay.
So only in case of expired bill, only that back update will happen.
So there are multiple status for a bill. So the active bills will be written directly. Other than that, there will be paid bills and expired bills. Those things will be updated. Once the demand is updated, new bills will be generated for them. Okay. So Aniket, bill service V2, line number 156. Bill service V2.
Yeah.
There, right? Mm-hmm. Line number 156.
Yeah.
So basically, here we will be searching the bill. Based on the response we are getting, if we don't get any bills, which means the bills are not present in the system, so basically new bills will be generated. And second thing, if we are getting the bill, we will be grouping them based on the, so line number 167, we will be grouping them based on the consumer code. The objects will be grouped into the consumer code keys. So then if you come to here, line number 180 in the for loop, so the expiry date of each bill will be checked. So basically, the expiry date given in the bill, you know, should be greater than the current date, which means the bill is a valid one. If it is lesser or equal to, which means the bill has become expired. So in that case, those expired consumer codes will be collected in the list, line number 176, consumer codes to be expired. So for those things, call will be made to the respective modules, I think. So line number 200, which calls the method update demands for expired bills, in which So the URLs which is updated in the application.property will be used to make call to the respective module. Once the demands are updated, new bills will be generated.
So we will have to, the bills have to be expired if we change the MDMS data, but if the bills are not expired, then it won't be updated, I guess the bills won't be updated.
No, so if the bills are not expired, it won't happen. It has to be expired for the system to re-update the demand again. They can manually, you know, set the bills to expire in the DB.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys can look at the code and then ask if there are any doubts. It's nothing complex there. We're just grouping them by the consumer code, and based on active or inactive, we are just updating and then creating new bills.
Okay. So, Vipin, anyone has any other questions related to this flow?
No, not to me. Again, we need to go through the flow and need to re-verify with you. We can.
Yeah, actually, once you run it on your local only, that time it will be more clear.
Right.
I guess Rohit is there. Rohit can explain how PDF service works.
Hi. Yeah, I can.
Yeah, Rohit, so, just share your screen and show how it's generated PDF.
PDF, yeah. So basically, there is a brief session on PDF tomorrow, but today I will go with just small descriptions of it. So, Aniket, so can I present?
Yeah. Just a minute. Yes, sir.
Rohit, tomorrow's presentation is mainly concentrated on how the configuration, different configurations, PDF configuration can be done, like data config and format config. So today's on the back end, like how the PDF service works.
Show the API, how the API request.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm only showing how the API request work and what it take into and all.
Yes, exactly.
Rohit, also, you have the HRMS collections, right? Just show one
slide. Fine, I can take that on HRMS. Tomorrow I can go for a PDF service briefly.
Yeah, explain
HRMS. So is the screen visible? Hello?
Yeah,
okay. So basically HRMS system is the simple system, and the EGOV services basically manage all the employee in the system. So basically their details, their service, their assignment and all. They're basically three main APIs: create, update and search. So just a minute. So are you able to see the flow? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. Basically there are three APIs: create, update and search. So when a client make a request to the HRMS system, it get all that validation data from the MDMS first. So basically this is the structure. This is the structure of an employee when we created. So ID, UID, status and all, adjudication, assignment, service history. I will give a brief description of it all. So just see a structure, education, test for an employee to have in a system. So as you can see the flow, it take a validation from the MDMS first and get a validation on the data provided in the system. Validation basically means they do a validate data on uniqueness on the mobile data and the username and all. And they also check about the employee data is provided, like the document, test detail, education detail and all. So after the validation is done, an ID is assigned to that application for that employee. So and this is done with the help of an IDGen service. So after all that application is created for the employee, it has a push to the user service. Actually, HRMS is in a subset of a user service. So basically, if there is a user in a user service, it doesn't mean that it will be present in the HRMS service. But HRMS service user will always be present in the user service data. So after the user is registered, means registering an employee means you are registering a user. So after employee is created, it has pushed the data to the Kafka topic and it will get persisted and stored in the database. I will just show you flow on a UI. So this is just, so this is a HRMS screen. The whole create employee is divided into the five section where provide the employee detail, duration detail, assignment detail, and service details. So we'll put all the data.
Not able to see the postman
sharing. No, postman not. I'm just showing the screen.
We are just visible. Hangout screen. Share the entire text.
I'm sharing just a minute. So now is it visible? Create employee screen. Aniket?
No.
Actually, it's for me. It's visible.
Oh, for me, it's not visible. Okay, fine. Then go ahead.
Yeah, Omkar, it is visible, right?
It's visible.
Yeah. In the first tab, you fill all the personal details of an employee, like you know the personal details. In corresponding address and all. So all that MDMS data has been taken from that config file, like what is the employment type, what is the role will be assigned, all the data get from the MDMS. That's all the link has been put in the document. I will share after this. They're like permanent, temporary, daily wage, contract, deputation, and all. The Aniket has shown that access control and access role file, that this is all that role get assigned to it. That like super user, employee, grievance officer, and all. So for if I create an employee within a property approver, so a property verifier, when an application is created for a property, right? So on, if I assign during action for verify, document verify, if I assign the role to Rohit, means send application to Rohit, then Rohit can approve that property application. So that's what a role is supposed to mean. So this has been done from the HRMS system for our employer. So here I'm giving an employer role. Now this is a jurisdiction tab. So basically jurisdiction. Hierarchy, revenue, boundary type, city. So jurisdiction nothing but the geographical area where that employee is currently is have all the power is. So basically the boundary type are means can be divided into the localities. Zone means employee has a power over that, over the city or a certain locality in a particular city. So that was this data means here.
Rohit, one thing. Actually, I remember there are two type of boundaries and that were having the different meaning. Can you explain it again? Whether what the meaning of revenue and one more type of boundary we used to be there.
Just a minute. Can you comment on the
I would like to add here. So yeah, I think you guys have seen the Uttarakhand specific instance, right? On so this boundary, it is something which is state specific. Okay. So yes, this testing instance which we have, this is modeled on lines of Punjab. So Punjab has a demarcation which goes like zone and then DDR and then city, ward and then mohalla. Whereas in Uttarakhand, it is simple like ULB, ward and mohalla. So that is why this is different for different setups. So this will basically come from the client requirement which you have.
So right now these are two in hierarchy. There is a revenue or there is an admin. So
yeah, basically this type of an whole department we are working on. Admin just if whether that employs an admin or not. Or revenue just a part of a department. We are just doing it here.
I remember somewhat like it's one is for property tax means calculation wise and means not quite clear. I somewhat remember like it's
basically within what revenue boundaries are, because revenue boundaries are defined in such a way that your rate slabs might differ. So in Punjab for some localities, the area type is given as area 1, for others area 2, and for other categories as area 3. So area 1 are the cost localities for which property rates charges are higher. So that is your revenue boundary, means your tax calculations are depending on your localities. Another is your admin boundary, I guess, will be something like what PGR service might be using, where only jurisdictional matter, like who has to take action here, who can, which officer can resolve this complaint. Like.
Correct, correct. So let me simplify that more. So for example, if there's a city, right? In a city, there are and basically the city administration divides that city based on various factors. So here in hierarchy, what you see is admin and revenue, right? So revenue, I mean, they can ideally be same or they can be different based on how the city has decided its boundary area. So admin basically signifies that like Aniket rightly said. So admin signifies that let's say officers who are looking after that particular boundary are responsible for all administrative matters. Okay, but revenue signifies that the officers in charge of that boundary are responsible for tax collection in that boundary. So maybe your revenue boundary might contain 2 to 3 admin boundary areas also. So it depends on how the local laws in that area are. So this is something which is very specific to the client requirement. So for example, they might say that they have one city might have just two admin boundaries, okay, area A and area B, but then they might have different revenue boundaries based on different tax slabs. So how nearer is it to the road, how posh is that area, or how much is the development in that area, and so on and so forth. So they might have multiple revenue boundaries but just two admin boundaries, or this is just an example, this might be different in different cases. Does that make any sense?
So normally in general, I think in the kind of, if we take our particular case, cantonment case, it will be only one. So there won't be, there will be same, ideally they should be same for revenue and admin boundary.
Correct. Right? Correct. So, in case of cantonment boards, they should be same. Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So, but I think just check, because I've seen one or two cantonment boards to have something known as zones. Okay. So in that case here, in case of cantonment boards, this will be zones and localities. So like this is there for revenue and admin, no? So in case of cantonment boards, that might be hierarchy might be zone and revenue.
Okay.
So when they give you boundary data, you will have better clarity on this.
Okay.
Go ahead, please, Rohit. Good. Thanks.
Yeah, sure. So now the assignment, it is the combination of all that the employee is having the current position, means what work is assigned to him right now. So give the detail, we have to mention the detail about it, from where the assignment has start, or the top to which date, or currently is it working or not, or on which department is it working right now. Just to take the detail of all it. So it's the service detail record would take off of an take the record of all the service that the particular employee has carried out from the entire his employed duration. So the assignment part and service parts looks same, but the assignment one for what the assignment it has been taken in all the tenure and service means in a particular department what has it has been done. It is a record of all the previous professional engagement of an employee, basically. Now this tab will take all the employer educational detail, departmental detail, and all. Just a basic detail of it.
Rohit, so when we say this assignment start date, okay, in that form we feel we can continue with that form only. So when we say the start date is, for example, today and till yesterday, whatever was pending us means, for example, he got an assignment of approver. Okay, he has to do the approver part, but the pending task is from yesterday. So till yesterday, whatever the task was pending, that won't be assigned to him or what?
No, that has to be completed first. No two assignment at a time can have it. A particular employee can have a single assignment at a time.
Okay. So, for example, if till yesterday, there was 100 of application came for approval. Okay. Mm-hmm. Till yesterday means.
That is the role, isn't it? No, the role is different. Assignment is different. Assignment is in a particular department, what is designation is, what is his position is. It's not right. Like role, you're talking about the role thing.
Right.
Yeah.
I think the question is, today this employee has been created and will he be eligible to process the files which have come yesterday? Say 100 files have come.
Mm-hmm.
Is he authorized to do that?
Yeah, yes. If correctly has that role, then he can do it.
Yeah, he can do
it. So that is the role significance for this behind this role action mapping. Okay. So we're doing here is this inbox. If you've seen employee inbox, it lists two tabs. One tab lists the actions which are marked directly for that employee, and second tab lists the actions which are marked to the department. Okay, so let's say if on 25th 100 files have come in for processing and on 26th one new employee is added to the department, if that employee is given the role, specific role and assignment of that department, that employee will be immediately able to see all the files marked to the department in their inbox.
Yeah, sure.
So another simple example I can give here is, I mean, for example, even in our current case, for example, our designation, what are the terms? Just scroll down a bit, Rohit.
Basically, property. Advice on property verifier, property approver, like this.
Correct. So, thoda sa upar assignment. Haan. जो असाइनमेंट डिटेल्स पे या सो
हियर वी कैन फाइंड द रोल द पर्सनल डिटेल एम्प्लॉइज एंड
सो देयर डेजिग्नेशन माइट बी लेट्स से सुपरिटेंडेंट इंजीनियर और जूनियर इंजीनियर समथिंग लाइक दैट बट देयर रोल माइट बी ट्रेड लाइसेंस क्रिएटर और ट्रेड लाइसेंस वेरीफायर व्हाटएवर बेस्ड ऑन व्हाटएवर रोल दे आर प्लेइंग करेक्ट
या
सो जस्ट अ पॉइंट टू बी नोटेड फॉर द बिल्डिंग
Yeah, for a particular department, he has the designation, and this role is performing right now. Correct. He can have a multiple role also.
So once he changed the department, all his role is removed actually.
Yes, that is correct. So the admin needs to realign his roles accordingly.
Yeah, while we do that updation, like all this validation has been taken care of when we update an employee. So basically, this is a summary page for filling after all that. Document, all that details. So here we call that over that user different. Okay. There's already a register here. Okay. I create a new one again.
No, then you can edit it, existing one. So the uniqueness is based on name and phone number or what?
Yeah, name, phone number.
Okay.
No, I think mainly phone number. Names also can be saved.
Yeah, username can be anything. It's basically based on that, phone number and employee's ID is...
Phone number and employee ID.
Phone number and employee.
So if the designation changes and if the role remains the same, there won't be much matter to the flow, right?
Yeah. So yeah, after creating an employee, you will get a messages regarding the password and the employee ID. So you can check the notification. You're able to see that terminal.
Yeah.
Just a minute. So here you will get a message like welcome to M7, your profile has been created. This is the username and this one is the password. This will message you get to register mobile number.
So for SMS, every service just creates its own SMS based on some template, yeah, and then pushes it on a specific Kafka topic. There is one Kafka topic of SMS, and then SMS service will pick and send it in a simple way.
Search API basically just make a call and take a data from the database and show it here. So this is the search preview page. And you can have have the authority to change the password and also the username for it. So basically we have that details, right? Employee and password. So as a employee role, at the beginning, you have only access to the two modules like complaint, property tax and finance. And from the profile page, you can change the password and all. So that's it for the HRMS system, HRMS service. You can, for further, you can refer to that doc, Confluence doc to it.
Okay.
Yeah. So any doubt or anything?
Nothing is
from us. You want to ask anything? Okay, then that's fine. So regarding the PDF service, we will have a session tomorrow. So right now.
Okay, so Gopesh, can you just show how report works, like the two APIs we have and from UI, how it fits and shows the data?
Yeah, Aniket, I will.
Aniket, in general, access to deploy, for example.
Yeah.
I'll ask it.
Yeah, we can go ahead. It will time, take time.
The point is, for example, miscellaneous collection, if I want to deploy, mm-hmm. So what are the mandatory services which has to be deployed? Like
other billing course, and collection.
Huh?
Only billing and collection. And user. Like billing, collection, and user. So, like thumb rule, what we follow is like you can just like go to the application.properties, right? And mm-hmm. there, whatever host we have put, all those we have considered. But for miscellaneous collection, user, billing, and collection.
Okay.
Even this HRMS service is also mandatory, right?
Yeah, to create the user one.
Okay.
HRMS, then even MDMS and those we have to set up.
MDMS,
HRMS, user.
But for miscellaneous collection, like if citizen is doing, then this HRMS service is required.
No, for that purpose.
No. So miscellaneous collection, even without that also, we can like citizen side, we can do like collection as well as payment, everything we can do.
Yeah, but payment, only online payment we can do.
Okay.
So we can share actually the list once the after this call we can share the list whatever is required to set up this service.
Okay, tomorrow session you will be connecting, right? You will be participating in that.
Which one?
Tomorrow session, because whatever the doubt we have after this local setup around that.
So yeah, I'll join. No problem.
Okay.
So Aniket, can I continue?
Yeah, go please, go.
Yeah. So this report framework, this report service is part of core service. So where just by writing a configuration file, a YAML file, we can generate any report in our system. So you can refer this document for detailed information about this report. Framework, and I will show you an example configuration of one report and show you how on front end we are accessing this. So for adding any report, we have to create a YAML file just like this. So here, this is an example of TL reports that we have added in our system. So after creating this config file, we have to mention this path in a file where all the where information about all the reports are kept. So we need to add this file to report service environment variable. So when the service is started, it reads all these reports. So basically, in report service, there are two types, two API calls. One is metadata call. Yeah. So one is metadata call and other is get data call. So like in metadata call, I will show you one example. Like, so this is a one report. So this card is fetched by metadata call. So in metadata call, we get what search fields we have to show to the user, and in a data call, when we click on search button, one second, just refresh this window. So in data call, we get actual data, like whatever query we have written. So I will go to
configuration of this report as an example. So here there are some sections like source columns, search params, base query, group by clause, order by clause. So all these will be used in this service. So whatever we want to, so as a part of metadata call, this information defined in this search columns will be sent to the front end. So this information contains what is the field type, and is it mandatory and all that. And once we get the data from user when he clicks on search, so when the data call is made, we append the data in base query based on the search clause.
So based on the search param, there will be search criteria available on the UI. Okay, just show the UI ones.
Yeah. So like here, there were three search params, like from date, to date, and there single value list type means there is a drop down. So this drop down is fetched from MDMS service. So these are the fields like drop down and from date to date. These three fields are there. So when if user fills any field, then this fields this information is sent with that data call. This is the second call. First we got the data about this one, this card, using metadata call, and second we are sending the user fields params to get the actual data. So I will show you how what data is sent and what data is received in each of these calls. So first this metadata call. So here the front end sent like what is the report name, report he want to get. So he has specified report name and the tenant ID for which the data is to be fetched. So in the response, the service has responded with this search params, like whatever we had defined in this config this search param. This is used here. So like same information is sent to the front end. So like label means what label we want to show here, like localization label, and name is just from this config. So this name field should match with within this query, like this clause will be directly appended after this query. So make sure that this field is being used in this query, like it should match one of these fields in the table. And so like type means client should send the data as a epoch, like not as when the user fills date, the data should be sent as an epoch. And similarly for third one, the second one is the same as the first one. And in the third one, so we have defined the label, and the name is that the field being used in the query, and type is single value list. So in single value list, it tells front end that this is a drop down, and based on the service call that we have defined here, the data will be sent to the front end and it will show that data as a drop down. So this is the metadata call, and once the citizen who employee searches this thing, he will get the data. So this response he got as part of data call, that is second call. So when the client requested for data call, so whatever parameters, if the parameter was null or empty, those will value, those field will not be appended, and only the field which are filled by the user, those will be appended after this base query in the end. And then the group by clause and order by clause, whatever we have defined here, those will be appended in the query. So once the query is final, then this import thing, it will fetch details from DB and send that data to front end.
This epoch is text field, right? Typing. Sorry? Type equal to epoch is for text field, right?
No, for date fields, right? Yeah.
Okay, date field. Okay.
So as part of data call, client will get these two fields. Like first will be the report header, like what columns we are showing here. So this the columns which we are showing to the user, those are defined as part of source column section. So here we have defined status. So this name should exactly match with the columns which we are getting as part of select query. And label is that a localization label which we want to show for that column. And the total is if we want the sum of all the columns in the as a footer. So these are the source columns. So these define what value would be shown on the client side. So this information sent to front end, like whatever was defined here in source column, the same information sent to front end. So like these label, name, and all that is relate to front end. So now the front end knows that this first column is status. Status and the second column is total. Now it has information about all the columns, and now the actual data will be sent as a list of values. So each value will be in the same order as the columns are defined here. So first value will be for this status column, second value will be for total column. So likewise, each row is sent here, and front end shows these values. And if there is any total column defined here, then it will show total also. So for example, for this column, we had defined total as true here. So this is this column is summed, and the value is shown. So this is about this. These are two calls, metadata and data calls. So I will again tell you the whole process, like how we are adding this any report. So first we will write the configuration of report, and then we will provide the file URL here, and then we will add it to report service path environment variables. For example, this path here we will provide the path of this file which contains information about all the reports. So this report service reads all this information and is ready for any report call. But one more thing is that we have to also define, like, for whom, which role we want to give access to these reports, like whether we want to give it to TL approver, TL document verifier. These information we have to add in access control. So for example, for this status report. Basically we need to, for each report, we have to define two entries in access control. One is that metadata call and other is this front end path, like which role should be able to access this role, this path. So those two entries we need to define in this access control thing. So for example, for status, we have defined here in access control thing. This is the path is MDMS master, and for Punjab we are using. So this is the path, total path. So here we will define what's the in details about this path. So here the name is defined and URL of the metadata call. So this parameters should vary. This path variable will vary with the reports. Like if there is some other report, we will use some other path. So likewise, this information is filled. So this is about giving access to metadata call. Now the other access control rule will be for who should be able to view this on front end. So for that we have defined here. So navigation URL means from home page, the path to reach to this report. So like here we have defined navigation URL as report rainmaker TL and state level report. So this trade license, this path variable is actually for that. Trade license reports and state level. So we will go to trade license, and we have reached here. And this is for side menu. This path variable is for showing that report on the side menu. So when the user clicks on this report, he will be redirected to this URL. So the for front end purpose, this URL is there. So he will reach to this point. So when he reaches to this web page, the metadata call is made that we had defined earlier. Yeah, this call will be made once the client, the user reaches to this page. So now we have defined the rules of action list, and now we will give the access to these action items, like who should be able to access these action items. So in access control roles, we will go there. And like we will use this ID to refer items here. So if we want to add, if we want to give an access to any role, we will add an entry here. So there will be a action ID, which will be the ID defined here, and the role code and the tenant ID for which state we want to give access. So also this ID thing should not be repeated and it should be sequential only. Otherwise in access control, it will create problem. So once we have defined the report and added into the report path and defined these access control rules, like who should be able to view the access to access the report, we can go ahead with the this is the overall thing, like what we have to do for adding any report. So tomorrow I will be explaining this configuration in detail. Like there are some special cases also, like sometimes we want to use some MDMS data in with these tables, and we want to show to the user, and like some special cases are there that I will explain tomorrow. So that is all from my side. So if anyone has questions, yeah.
Okay, we provide the free text search, means user can search anything in that particular, for example, trade license related table. Anything he can search rather than giving only a specific option like from date to date or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That is it. He can search panel. Yeah, he will be allowed to do free text search. It's just that the direct value will be appended after this query.
Okay. So one more thing is like this, which you are defining in the YAML file, your form design completely dynamic, right? So the same strategy is following any type of form design, or it's specifically followed for report generation or report generation module?
Yeah, it is specifically designed for this report generation.
Okay. So in other case, it's how it's done in case of, for example.
We have different configurations for DSS. So for dashboards and all those things, we have separate configurations. Only for report service, we have this configuration. So you are talking about dashboards, right?
No, I'm talking about the how the UI is coming up. In case of a report, it's through the YAML. You are reading all the elements, and based on that, you are populating the thing.
Yeah.
So in case of, but it's not same as other cases, like other modules.
No. Other models are not that dynamic. So we have some components like workflow components that comes dynamically from the business service we define. In the reports, the tables come from the report framework.
Okay.
Yeah. So UI will be there separate, I guess.
Yeah, it's there.
So for a report thing, this URL will be common. Only this report name will change for any report.
So when we are giving the action permission, we are giving till endpoint, right? Action mapping, state license report, or we are giving only up to report slash rainmaker.
No, whole path we are
giving. Okay.
Complete path.
So it's basically same as whatever we give for any API, the complete path.
Yeah. Okay. This way we can define rule for every report separately. Like.
Okay.
Omka. Hello. I guess we can actually now have local setup, and then we can proceed further, because it's anyway too much to begin for one session.
Okay, so you're saying tomorrow's session first we can cover local setup and then move on to
Yes, I am fine if we want to start now also. Let me see.
So guys, well team, what do you guys think? Do you want to continue for some more time on local setup, or you want to take it up before tomorrow's session?
One thing to confirm, like this DB setup is required for this local setup.
Yeah, Postgres you will be.
Because we didn't download that part.
Okay, just download Postgres and install Kafka, then we can start tomorrow in local.
Okay, and kubectl related thing also we have to download, right?
Kubernetes, yes, just download Kubernetes also.
Okay.
Yeah. So Kubernetes, Postgres, Postman.
Yeah, other things are already mentioned. So Postgres was
missed there, I think.
I think in that Postgres I just missed it, or maybe I would have missed it. Okay.
So there are some few services like localization, which are like straightforward only. So whatever code we have in backend, there is a message which you have to show. So it's just that mapping. So that anyway, we can, when we go through local setup, we can see how the code works. Like we can put debugger and so, see how the data flows through the code. That okay, will give okay. clearer picture, I guess.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
In that case, we conclude for today, right? Any more questions, queries?
The local setup will be done on Ubuntu environment or Windows?
Yes, we recommend Ubuntu environment.
Okay.
So as you can see from the screens, all of the developers, they use Ubuntu.
From Windows, it's not like fine. And some people work on Windows.
Yeah, we have created a VM environment for like Ubuntu SSH. So both the things we can do. Yeah, preferable. Yeah. Just wanted to ask. Like, okay.
Yeah, Ubuntu is like preferable, but fine. We can work on any node.
Okay. Other than like any specific reason of moving to Ubuntu, one is open source. Another one is.
No, nothing else. It's easier to
Okay. Shashikala ma'am, are you there? She is there, but okay.
Yes, VP.
So ma'am, tomorrow or I mean?
Just wanted to check, we'll conclude today, right?
Yes.
There are no more questions. We'll conclude today. So tomorrow's session, what we'll do is we'll start with the local setup first and then continue with PDF and all these things.
Yeah, this local setup also, Onkar, like do we need server? That is because setting up, like we are like we are connecting to your team through Slack channel.
Uh-huh.
And we are trying to get it resolved, some few of the issues.
No, so you will not need a server. You will just need at least one environment set up with all the services. So then you can, what you can do is you can point the local variables to that environment and then access the services, access the APIs that way, services, that microservices.
Okay, that will be a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can do that. Is before the training you want us to set it up? That is like somebody will take the class on that?
Correct,
tomorrow?
Correct. So tomorrow, before initiating the PDF generation, which session is there tomorrow? Reporting and PDF generator is there tomorrow. So while getting into that session only, we'll first cover local setup and then we'll start with the actual session.
For that invitation, invite you are going to send for that?
I've already sent invite for that.
Okay, fine.
Just 1 minute. When you're saying the local setup means we will be deploying all the services in the local environment or one server, local server, that will be sufficing, right?
Means
required service.
Trade license and persister we can start locally, and other users, same DMS, we can point to either Dev or your server if it's
that's
right.
Anywhere
we can
point,
not a problem.
Anywhere. That's what we wanted to confirm.
So I'll clarify. So Vipin, you need to have at least the dev environment set up at your end before pointing the endpoints to that environment with all the services.
Okay.
Chicken.
But that's what it's going on, Onkar. Like the they're stuck. If both the sandbox DevOps team is stuck.
No, sir. Let them raise those issues on Slack. No, Shashikala. So
yeah, going on. Actually, that channel is on.
Uh-huh.
So let us see. Might be by tomorrow they may succeed.
Yeah. So I think it is very crucial now that the infra is set up. Otherwise, it will be a problem.
I know that's going on because they are also day and night. They are both are working.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Pradeep and Madhvi both are working actually in different.
Okay, let us give it a shot first. Otherwise, we'll see what can be done.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Aniket.
Okay. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thank you, Aniket. Gopesh.
Thank you, Aniket.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Thank you all.
Omkar, will be you are putting the recording, Anna? Or
recording also.
Only two sessions are there, right, Omkar, in the Jira?
Yeah. Till now, I've shared only two sessions. So one session Madhvi had recorded, that's on Loom. And one okay. session recording I've already shared. So I'm just discussing with Elzan. We'll release most of the dump by tomorrow or day after tomorrow.
Okay. Vipin, two
today's
are there.
Session you can expect.
Vipin, two sessions are recorded sessions in Jira. It is recorded. Yeah, like Omkar has shared. Might be we will, we have to make an arrangement to download that in any one place and
keep it in repositories. Yeah, I already shared that in group. Like that is for DevOps. Today's session at least it can be shared with, because it, I don't think so it's having any password related things. So yeah, previous data was having. So
correct. No, so that's what I will check with Elzan. We'll share all the videos with tomorrow or by day after max.
Sure.
Take it. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.